بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وبعد inshallah tonight basically what I want to do is just give some general points about Tafseer and then inshallah discuss one of the famous translations of the Quran into English, Yusuf Ali's translation. And also, if we have time, also discuss Muhammad Asad's translation and some of the points concerning these two works. First of all, we should realize that Tafsir is one of the most important sciences in Islam, because it's through Tafsir that we learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, and we understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires from us. So because of this reason, the ulama have discussed Tafsir in great detail and have discussed many of the principles concerning Tafsir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, Alhamdulillahi alladhi yanzala ala abdihi al-kitab wa lam yaj'alahu iwaja. And it praise be to the one who has revealed to his slave the book and has placed no any crookedness therein. And meaning that the book, the Quran, is something clear for the most part. And another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the opening of Surat Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Alif Lam Mim, that is the book in which there is no doubt, guidance for those who are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even though we have this book, and the book is clear, it is still possible for us to be misled. And even though we have the book and we read the book, it's still possible for us to be misled. And that's basically through two ways. Number one, if we try to interpret the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. And we read the Quran and we give the Quran some meaning when we don't actually have the proper requirements to give tafsir or to explain the Quran. And this is very dangerous and one of the ways that we may be misled. Now there's a number of hadith of the Prophet that say that if anyone interprets the Quran according to his opinion, his ra'i, then he shall take a seat in the hellfire and these kinds of meanings. All of these hadith are weak. They are not authentic. But still, if we look at the Sahaba, we look at how they looked to the Qur'an, we see that they were very careful when it came to giving any meaning to any verse in the Qur'an. Abu Bakr, for example, the first Khalifa, said that, what earth will give me a place to live and what sky will give me shade if I should say something about the Qur'an, by my opinion, or something that he does not know for sure is correct. So explaining the Qur'an is not something simple. Is something very important, but at the same time it has to meet certain correct characteristics. And if we approach the Quran without the requisite knowledge, it's very easy for us to get the wrong conclusions from the Quran. For example, there's a verse in the Quran that says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَحٌ فِيمَا تَعِمُوا مَا إِذَا تَقَوُوا وَآمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ ثُمَّ تَقَوُوا وَآمَنُوا ثُمَّ تَقَوُوا وَأَحْسَنُوا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, basically what the meaning of the verse is that there's no blame upon those people who believe and do good deeds concerning what they eat or what they drink, as long as they are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they believe and they do good deeds and they are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believe and they are aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do good. Well, if we look at this verse, and we're not familiar with how to interpret the Quran, as one of the early scholars, or one of the early personalities in Islam, when he read this verse, he concluded that alcohol is halal. And because the verse says that for those people who believe, there's no sin upon them concerning whatever they eat, or whatever they drink. So this man, when he read this verse, he said, therefore, alcohol is halal, and there's nothing wrong with it. The mistake he made is that he didn't follow the proper steps in Tafseer. He didn't look at the circumstances behind the verse. Or in other words, he didn't have the proper knowledge to interpret this verse. This verse was revealed after the prohibition of alcohol. And some of the Muslims, they were worried about those Sahaba who died before alcohol was prohibited. So they asked the Prophet, what about these people who died and they were drinking alcohol? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse concerning them, that there's no sin upon them for what they drank, as long as they were aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believed and did good deeds. So without the proper background, without the proper knowledge, it's very easy for us to get misguided, even though we have the Quran and we know it is a clear book. One time Umar ibn al-Khattab, he called the Muslims together and he asked Ibn Abbas, the Sahabi, that the Prophet ﷺ made dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would increase his knowledge and his understanding of the Quran. He asked Ibn Abbas, how could it be that the Muslims have one prophet, one book, and one Qibla, and they will fight each other? They will differ and they will fight each other. So Ibn Abbas answered him. He said that you and I, we read the Quran, and we know concerning what it was revealed. So therefore we both understand it and we both know what it means. But there will come a people who will read the Quran, and they will not know concerning what it's been revealed, and therefore they'll interpret it according to their opinions. And when they interpret it according to their opinions, then they will differ, and when they differ, they will fight each other. So even though we have this Quran, which is a clear book from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, still if we don't have the proper knowledge, the proper tools to interpret it, and we may still be misguided even though we have this book. And the second way of being misguided, even though we have the Quran, is if we approach the Quran with certain preset notions. And we have our beliefs already, and then we go to the Quran, we try to prove our beliefs from the Quran. Well, in the history of Islam, this happened on a number of occasions. The Shia, for example, the Mu'tazila, the Shia, for example, they take the verse, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَبَّهُ بَقَرَةً, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered you to slaughter the cow. They say, هِيَ عَائِشَةً, that this is a command. They say the cow in this verse means Aisha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ordering the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to slaughter Aisha, according to the Shia commentators. And because they have their beliefs and they just try to go to the Quran or to try to go to the Hadith and prove their beliefs from the Quran or from the Hadith. And this is, as I said, unfortunately, it's common amongst all, actually, of Ahl al-Bidah. All of the groups that are not following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of them try to go to the Quran and prove their beliefs from the Quran, even though in fact their beliefs are not consistent with the Quran. To take another example, maybe more intricate, a group called the Mu'tazila, they do not believe in the intercession of the Prophet ﷺ. There's a hadith in which the Prophet ﷺ said that my intercession, or I will intercede for Ahl al-Kabair of my Ummah. I will intercede for those people who committed the great sin. I will intercede for them and they will be taken out of the hellfire and taken to paradise. The Mu'tazila, they don't believe in this. They believe that if you commit great sins and you're an unbeliever, or you'll be an unbeliever and you'll be in hellfire forever. So they say, what's the meaning of this hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that I will intercede for Ahl al-Kabair, is the word in Arabic. They say Ahl al-Kabair are those people who pray and have patience. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surat al-Baqarah, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ, that bear with patience in prayer, and it is a big thing, لَكَبِيرَةٌ, except for those people who are humble. And they completely ignored the proven principles of the Arabic language and said that Ahl al-Kabair is referring to this verse. So if we approach the Qur'an with our own ideas already set, instead of letting the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ give us our aqidah, this is another way that we'll be misled, even though we have the Qur'an in front of us. Well, the scholars of Islam have clearly stated what are the principles, or what are the basics of tafsir. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an says in a verse, ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا بَيَانَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying it's upon us to explain the Qur'an. Us is referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is upon us to explain the Qur'an. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not reveal the Qur'an and leave the explanation open to anyone who comes to the Qur'an. Also, this means that the meaning of the Qur'an is one. Many people, including Yusuf Ali and Muhammad Asad, they claim that they believe in a kind of progressive tafsir, that over the years, the meaning of the Qur'an changes according to our understanding of life. As Abdullaah Yusuf Ali says in his introduction to his Qur'an, introduction to his translation, that he says in spiritual matters, he believes in the kind of progression of understanding. While this verse in the Qur'an, ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا بَيَانَا, makes it clear that the meaning of the Qur'an is one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained it. And he has given the meaning actually. And that meaning doesn't change over time. You cannot say that the meaning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam understood this verse to mean this, but in fact today it means something else. This is something that you find amongst the Christians that is completely alien to the spirit of Islam. The lessons for each generation from the Qur'an might be different. The lessons are related to the circumstances, but the meaning is one. I mean, the meaning doesn't change over time. Well, the principles of the Qur'an, I mean of tafsir, is first, if we want to explain a verse, we should go to the Qur'an itself. Because the Qur'an is one book and one revelation, and as some of the ulama said, it is like one statement or one sentence. And no part contradicts the other. In fact, each part explains the other part. So the first thing we want to do, if we want to find the meaning of a verse, we go to the Qur'an itself. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surat al-Fatiha, we read in this surah, we say, اَحْدِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those whom you have blessed, or whom you have graced with your favor. But who are those people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed with His favor? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Qur'an, in another verse, in Surah Al-Na'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains who these people are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ يُطِيَ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains to us who those people are whom He has blessed in the other verse by saying that whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, he'll be with those people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed from the prophets, from the siddiqeen or the sincere, and the martyrs, and the salihin or the righteous. So when we say اَهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, we're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the path of the prophets, of the siddiqeen, of the martyrs, and of the salihin. So one verse explains the other verse of the Qur'an. And there's many examples of that. For example, in one verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed certain words to Adam to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that verse doesn't say what those words are. But in another surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states the dua that He inspired to Adam. So the first principle is that we take the Qur'an, if we want to understand any verse, we first try to understand it in the light of the other verses of the Qur'an. And what this means also is that if anyone interprets the Qur'an, if anyone interprets one verse of the Qur'an in such a way that it contradicts another verse of the Quran, obviously that kind of tafsir must be rejected. And that's clear, inshallah. The second source of tafsir of the Quran is the Sunnah of the Prophet. In fact, that was part of his job, to explain the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا بَيَانَا, he's including يعني, the fact that he sent the Prophet and part of the Prophet's job was to explain the Quran. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرِ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Says, we have revealed unto you the dhikr, or as the Mufassirin say, the Sunnah of the Prophet, in order to explain unto mankind what has been revealed to them. What is the Prophet who showed us, for example, how to pray? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us in the Quran to establish the Salat, the Salat. But nowhere does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran show us exactly how the prayer is to be performed. Yani how many raka'at, what do we say in the different positions, what position follows the other position. This is only to be found in the Sunnah of the Prophet. The Sunnah is the actual implementation of the Quran. So if we want to see how the Quran is meant to be understood, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant the Quran to be understood, or what's the meaning of the Quran in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes, the second thing we do, we look to the Sunnah of the Prophet. And there's many verses in the Quran also that we can see that the Sahaba did not understand them properly until they went to the Prophet and he explained it to them. As the verse that says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِمَانُهُمْ بِبُونَ. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing those people who believe and they do not mix their belief with any dhulm. Well, dhulm has many meanings. And if we just, if we wanted to make tafsir over the Quran and we come to this verse, and it has many meanings that we can get from the word dhulm. Well, even the Sahaba, they misunderstood this verse. Because they said, who doesn't do some wrong? And even though he's a believer, he does some wrong. So the Prophet ﷺ had to explain to them that the meaning of this verse is shirk. I mean, the meaning of the word dhulm in this verse is shirk. And he doesn't mix his belief with shirk. So therefore the Sahaba, even though they were experts in the Arabic language, they did not get the proper meaning of this verse. What this implies is that, and in order to get the proper meaning, it is not sufficient even to be expert in the Arabic language, but we have to go to the Sunnah of the Prophet. One of the Tabi'een, he came to Umar ibn al-Khattab, and he asked Umar ibn al-Khattab about the prayer of the traveler. He said that, why do we pray two rak'at when traveling instead of four when we're in a period of safety? Because the Quran, and the verse in the Quran describing the traveling, the prayer while traveling, has a condition. In khaftum, yani if you fear the enemy, then you may shorten your prayer. So this tabi, he understood it, that if we don't fear any enemy, then we cannot shorten the prayer while traveling. So he asked Umar ibn al-Khattab about it. And Umar ibn al-Khattab said, I had the same feeling, I had the same understanding, so I went to the Prophet ﷺ and asked him. And the Prophet ﷺ said, this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a rukhta, you have to accept this gift. So again, what this implies is that even an excellent command of the Arabic language is not sufficient to make tafsir. You have to refer to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And as I said, this was one of the roles or one of the jobs of the Prophet ﷺ, to explain the Quran in the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wished for it to be explained. And one of the reasons for many people making mistakes in tafsir is that they neglect to look to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and how he explained the Quran. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى وَالْزِيَادَةِ. For those people who do Ahsanu is not those who do good, but I would say those who do good. And they will get good in return and something in addition. Muhammad Asad is one of those people who wrote in the Quran who doesn't like to look too much to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ explained this verse very clearly. He said that the ziyadah, something in addition, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove the hijab or the veil in front of him and the believers, and in the hereafter they will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Muhammad Asad doesn't believe that anyone can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so therefore he came to the Quran with preconceived notions, as I mentioned earlier. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse says wa ziyada, instead of taking what the Prophet ﷺ explained the meaning to be, he simply said that they will get good and something more than they deserve. And in other words, he refused to interpret the Quran in the way that the Prophet ﷺ explained it. And the third principle of explaining the Quran, besides the other verses of the Quran, besides the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, is looking through the basics, or the Arabic language and its rules. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states in the Quran that this Quran has been revealed in Arabic language. So therefore the rules, yani, of the sentences, the grammar, the structure, even the vocabulary, it is based on the Arabic language. If we try to interpret the Quran, and unfortunately many Americans do this, but not intentionally, inshallah, they read the translation of the Quran and they get some meaning from the translation, and that meaning is completely inconsistent with the actual Arabic of the Quran. In addition to that, also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that every messenger has been sent with the tongue of his people. So what that means also is that the Quran is not only in Arabic, but it has been revealed in the Qurayshi Arabic of the time of the Prophet ﷺ. So in other words, if there's a word that has a meaning during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and later its meaning's changed, and it's found in the Quran, that meaning is the meaning from the time of the Prophet ﷺ. It's not the new meaning that came later. For example, and I was trying to think of before the talk for an example which is less trivial than this one, but I could not think of it, so I'll give this example anyway. The word kalima. The word kalima, now if you ask almost any, Arab, what's the meaning of the word kalima, they'll tell you it means word. And the word harf means letter. But actually during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the word kalima meant complete sentence. This is why the shahada, la ilaha illallah, is called kalimat tayyiba. A good sentence, not words. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, when he said you will receive 10 rewards for each harf of the Quran, he said for each word of the Quran, but then he explained it. And he said, I don't mean alif, lam, mim is harf, like in alif harf, wa mim harf, wa lam harf, wa mim harf. So the meaning of these two words have changed over time. So when we come to it in the Quran, we don't take the later meaning, we have to apply the earlier meaning. Or the meaning that is from the time of the Prophet. And one of, by the way, of the important aspects of the Arabic language is that every Arabic word has, we can call, a basic meaning. And then it might have other meanings which are less common or less usual in the Arabic language. So according to the Arabic language, that every word has, we're supposed to understand every word according to its basic meaning, unless there's some evidence to explain it, to understand it some other way. In other words, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks in the Quran about al-arsh, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The meaning of arsh in the Quran, the Arabic language, is clear. So therefore, when talking about the meaning of the Quran, we cannot go from that word and give it some other meaning which in fact is not related to it. Like say his power or his authority. I mean, this is not acceptable. This is known as ta'wil, which is unacceptable. A type of scripture twisting, as the biblical scholars call it. So before getting to Abdullaah Yusuf Ali's tafsir, there's another verse in the Quran which I would like to mention and discuss a little bit. And that's the verse in the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هو الذي أنزل عليك الكتاب منه آيات محكمات هن أم الكتاب وأخر متشابهات. This verse in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that there's two types of verse in the Quran. Al-muhkama, or the ones which are clear, wal-mutashabihat. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues in that verse, هو الذي ينزل عليك الكتاب نهاية المحكمة وخروا متشابهات فمن نعم فأما الذين في قلوبهم زيغ فيتبعون ما تشابه منه يبتغون الفتنة وابتغاء التأويل وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا وما يذكر إلا أولو الألباب. Also what can be read also, وما يعلم تأويله إلا الله والراسخون في العلم يقولون آمنا به كل من عند ربنا. This verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is dividing, as I said, the verse in the Quran into two texts, muhkamat wal mutashabihat. And he said that those people who have a disease in their heart, they go after al mutashabihat, trying to make some fitna, trying to make some differences amongst the people, and trying to get its real meaning. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, but no one knows its real meaning except Allah. And those people of knowledge, they say, we believe in all of it, it is from our Lord. But this verse can also be read that no one knows its meaning except Allah and those people of knowledge who say we believe in all of it. And if both readings are correct, but they have different meanings depending on how you read it. First of all, what we get from this verse is that most of the Quran is not mutashabih. Okay. And most of the verses in the Quran are clear. Muhammad Asad in his Tafseer, he claims that most of the Quran is mutashabih. Most of the Quran is open to interpretation and we give it different meanings over time. And this is not true according to this this verse in the Quran. Also, the mutashabihat, something could be mutashabih to one scholar while it is clear to another scholar. And it is actually a relative term. If someone finds the meaning, for example, in the Sunnah, or is clear from the Arabic language to him, then the verse is no longer mutashabih. While to another scholar, it might be mutashabih. Finally, with respect to the last part, ما يعلم التأويل إلا الله والراسخون في العلم. If we mean the tafsir of the verse, or what's the verse mean, then yes, the people of knowledge know what the verse means. If we mean the actual, for example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Jannah, if we mean, do we actually know what Jannah is exactly, how it will look, and how we'll feel it, and so forth, this is called the ta'wil of the verse. And this, of course, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows right now. We do not know. So that's according to the second reading. But what is clear, according to all of the ulama, the mu'ajizat, or the miracles of the prophets, alayhi salam, they are not from the mutashabihat. Muhammad Asad, he claims that any miracle stated in the Quran is from the mutashabihat, and he tries to give some interpretation for it. Ashab al-Kahf, for example, the people of the cave who slept for 300 years, and this is completely unacceptable to Muhammad Asad. So he said this is a group of Jewish scholars that went to the mountains to study. And they lived there with their families, and they lived generation after generation for 300 years before the people found out about them. With respect to the birds who protected Mecca from the elephant, also he said this was like smallpox or something. And he tries to give some explanation. With respect to, I think that's sufficient. These mu'ajizat, according to all the ulama, the salaf, all the early scholars of Islam, they are not from the mutashabihat. In other words, they mean what they say. And these miracles actually were performed by the will and by the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, al-ayat al-sifat, or the ayat, the verses referring to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his attributes, are also not from the mutashabihat. In one sense. In another sense, of course they are, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives any one of His attributes, we know what it means, but we cannot say what its exact nature means. In other words, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He hears, we know what hearing means, but we cannot say exactly how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears. They said the reason I brought this verse up is because there's many people who claim that many verses of the Quran are mutashabihat, inconsistent with how the Prophet ﷺ explained the Quran, and it's completely inconsistent with the Arabic language. But we have to be familiar with what they do. And as Muhammad Asad did, he claims that most of the Quran is mutashabih, and from this foundation, he can interpret the Quran in almost any way he wishes. At the turn of the century, unfortunately, especially in Egypt and other parts of the Muslim world, they were greatly influenced by, and really they greatly marveled at, the scientific civilization of Europe. And so therefore they began to, some of the scholars, and by the way, their intention, and we're not talking about their intention, because their intention was to defend Islam. One of the scholars who brought about secularism, although he didn't mean to, in Europe, was a man by the name of Kant. Kant was a firm believer in God. But he said that the rules of the hereafter, the rules of the unseen, or the logic of the unseen, doesn't apply to the logic of this world. He thought he's defending Christianity, but in fact, what he did pretty much led to the destruction of Christianity. So the same thing with respect to these scholars like Muhammad Abdu and Jamaluddin Afghani, Rashid Rida. Yani they were trying to defend Islam. They thought what they were doing is defending Islam. What they did was wrong. And there's no question what they did was wrong or what they said was wrong. We have to reject what they said. But at the same time, we do not have to condemn the person and talk about his intention. Inshallah, their intention was to defend Islam. So when they admired the Western civilization, scientific civilization, they began to interpret the Quran in very materialistic ways. As I alluded to earlier with Muhammad Asad, they began to they began to deny all of the mu'ajizat, or all of the miracles stated in the Quran. They began to deny most of the sifat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. And they began to interpret the Quran almost not as the Quran is supposed to be interpreted, but as the Western, or as Europe, they interpreted in terms really of European society. Well, unfortunately, Abdullaah Yusuf Ali is one of the people who was affected by that movement. And in his Tafseer, there's many places we see that he has made some mistakes, and sometimes the mistakes were gross mistakes. We hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives Abdullah Yusuf Ali for his mistake and rewards him for the service that he did to Islam. But at the same time, we should not ignore the mistakes he made. So I've written down some of the points from his tafsir, some of the footnotes. In footnote 44, for example, Yusuf Ali is under the belief, and he states it clearly in different places in his tafsir, that there's no such thing actually as heaven and hell, but they are just state of mind. And heaven is a place where you just feel felicity in your mind, and hell is a place where you just feel torture in your mind. He doesn't actually believe in heaven and hell as places where there will be resurrection, and all of mankind will be resurrected, body and soul, and they will live in this new existence. He mentions that in footnote 44 of his commentary, and in many different places. Obviously, if we go back to the three principles, or the three tools used to make tafsir, the Quran itself, the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and the Arabic language, and this obviously contradicts all three of them. Because the Quran is clear about heaven and hell, the Sunnah or the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is clear, and also the Arabic language, if we go to the Quran, and it is clear. also with respect to Iblis or the Shaitan in general, and also Muhammad Asad in his Tafseer, in his appendix, he has the same kind of thing. With respect to Iblis, he says in footnote 52 that Iblis is the power of evil. He believes in it as something like the evil conscience in mankind. He does not believe in a creature created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Iblis. He believes it's some kind of evil power, evil conscience. Or just if someone does something wrong, then we say this is related to Iblis, but in fact there's no such thing as Iblis. Well, if we go to the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the angels to bow down to Adam. And among the people who were commanded to bow down to Adam was Iblis, and he refused. And he even said something. So this kind of interpretation goes clearly against the Quran. And how is it the power, supposedly some kind of power of evil, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states it as a kind of special creature? In footnote 168, we get a very clear example of where Abdullaah Yusuf Ali is ignoring the Sunnah of the Prophet. And this is a footnote to a verse which is talking about all of mankind has to pass over the fire. All of mankind will pass over the fire. Well, the Prophet explained this as the Surat, the path over the hellfire. And for some people they will go quickly, and for other people they will struggle, and so forth. But the Prophet clearly explained the meaning of this verse. And if the Prophet said something, we cannot go to something else. But again, Yusuf Ali refused to follow what the Prophet said, and he calls it the fire of repentance. Now there's nowhere in the Quran or in the Hadith, or even in the Arabic language in the Quran, there's nowhere anything such as the fire of repentance. And he says, all of us must pass through the fire of repentance. And because he's not willing to look to the Sunnah of the Prophet to see what this hadith, what this verse really means, he has to come up with some strange tafsir. With respect to also the story of Ibrahim, the Prophet Abraham, the story in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how he recreates the dead, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to cut up some birds and put them on hills and then call them and they'll come to him. As I said, this is one of the mu'jizat or miracles explained in the Quran. Of course, Yusuf Ali in footnote 308. In footnote 308, Yusuf Ali completely denies there's any miracle to this. He said the birds were not killed and they did not come back to Ibrahim in that way. And of course, if the birds were not killed and not brought back to life, there's no meaning to this verse whatsoever. Because Ibrahim asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show him how he recreates the dead, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to do this, while according to Abdullah Yusuf Ali, he did not do it. They were not dead. So his meaning, it clearly contradicts the earlier verses of the Quran in the same passage. Also with respect to some of his fiqh points that he makes in the tafsir also. For example, he says war is only in self-defense, in footnote 204. He said war is only in self-defense, while we know, and he's talking about jihad, by the way, he's not talking about war. War and jihad are not the same thing. We don't have anything such as war in Islam. But we know that jihad is not just self-defense, but jihad is meant to spread the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throughout the earth. If there's a non-Muslim country that does not allow us to spread the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless of whether they attack us or not, we have to make jihad against them. So jihad is not just in self-defense. But as I said, Yusuf Ali came from a certain period of time which many of the Muslims were trying to almost make apologies for Islam and try to show that Islam is not as some people claim, and therefore unfortunately this influenced his commentary in the Quran. In footnote 324 he talks about riba. According to the Arabic according to the Arabic definition of the word riba, which means, in fact, any increase, any addition to the capital, there's only one way that riba could be translated into English, and that is as interest. It is not usury. Riba is not usury. Usury means an exorbitant amount of interest, a very large, very high interest rate compared to what the market can bear. Well, riba is any kind of interest. It's not usury, it's any kind of interest. So first of all, he translates it as usury, which is a mistake. But in his commentary to this verse, he said that, well, you know, things change over time and people interpret the Quran according to their time. Well, actually, this is a word clear in the Arabic language. And then he says that riba in the Quran is not the same thing which is the creation of the modern banking system. In other words, he's saying that the interest that the banks charge is not the same thing as riba. So you may take loans and whatever with the banks. By the way, all of these so far are just from Surat al-Baqarah. Just from Surat al-Baqarah. I didn't have time to go. Hamid called me just a few minutes before I left. I was just about to leave to the airport when he called to tell me I had two extra talks and I had to gather my notes together. All these are from Surat al-Baqarah. I'll just mention one more, and that's footnote 929, in which he talks about the jinn, and he said the jinn are the hidden qualities or capacities in man. Well, this is interesting because the Quran says what? The Quran says that the Prophet told the Prophet that a group of the jinn listened to the Quran. And it seems that Yusuf Ali, sometimes he didn't read the whole Quran, if you read his Tafseer. Anyhow, if you're going to translate jinn as the hidden qualities or capacities in men, then what do these other verses mean that say that the group of jinn listened to the Quran? And of course all of the hadith related to that. Well, those are some of the points from Abdullah Yusuf Ali's translation and commentary on the Quran. And for many years, scholars have talked about revising this translation. Well, there was a committee in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, made up of about 30 ulama. Jafar Sheikh Idris was one of them. Sheikh Mustafa Al-Adami was one of them. Well, their job was to revise Yusuf Ali's translation of the Quran. Well, they didn't get very far. Because the Ba and Bismillah, they had about 12 different opinions about how it should be translated. So after discussing the Ba and Bismillah for about 3 or 4 days, the whole project kind of fell apart. But alhamdulillah, there have been recently a man of publications, they have published a revised edition. Well, Yusuf Ali has many, unfortunately, it's still one of the best translations in English, unfortunately. But there's many, many mistakes in Yusuf Ali's tafsir or commentary. And unfortunately, the revised edition was not able to get rid of all of these mistakes. For example, many of the footnotes that I mentioned, some of them, they deleted them completely. Others, they did not quite delete them, and some they just left alone. So the revised edition is far better, much better than the old edition. I mean, they deleted a lot of stuff that should have been deleted, but it's still very far from perfect. And as I said, to remove everything from Yusuf Ali, which is questionable, would in fact take a great work. I mentioned Muhammad Asad's Tafsir quite a few times because it is also gaining in popularity. And I mentioned some of the mistakes that he made. He is kind of like a modern-day Mu'tazila. And his Tafsir is really a Mu'tazili Tafsir of the Quran. Well, Mu'tazila is a group, as you all know, that existed in the history of Islam. And they have their five principles and so on. And his principles, his tafsir is basically according to their beliefs. I talked about how he denies all of the miracles. I mentioned the Quran. He also denies all of the positive attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In his appendix to the Quran, and his appendix to his translation, he says we cannot say anything about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except what he is not. And he is not imperfect, he is not this, he is not that. some scholars before him who had the same way of thinking. They even reached such an extreme that they even said he is not in existence and he is not in existence. He is not mujood, he is not mujood. So what he's doing basically is all of those verses in the Quran that state attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like he is ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and these people are saying, no, we cannot say he's ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So I don't know even how they pray when they say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it must mean nothing to them. He's saying we can only say what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't. He isn't imperfect, he isn't incomplete, he isn't this, he isn't that. And finally, just one last point about Muhammad Asad. I don't know how long you wanted me to speak, Hamid, but I hope inshallah. Well, I hope I've spoken long enough then. One last point about Muhammad Asad's tafsir is his, there's many things also we could say about his tafsir, his commentary, but his note to Surat al-Nur, the verse concerning the dress of the women, he does something very nice on this. His argument is that the dress of the women should be modest. And modesty is something that changes over time. In other words, during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, it was one thing, but nowadays, it's something completely different. So nowhere does he state what exactly the dress of the woman is supposed to be according to the Fiqh. But he does also another nice thing in that footnote. He quotes an earlier scholar who said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the women to cover what they should be covered except what he permits them or except what may be uncovered without loss of modesty. So he takes this quote from Tafsir al-Kabir by Imam al-Razi. And the problem is he takes just half the quote. He said this, the quote, as he states, that women may uncover, or the women have to cover whatever is deemed necessary by custom. And he just leaves it at that. But if you go to Tafsir al-Razi, the scholar he quoted says that, and that the women may uncover, according to the Quran, is the face and hands. Okay, he leaves that part out. And he says just, according to custom, and then he argues that, well, custom changes over time. And, of course, for those people who do not have Tafsir al-Kabir, which is a big tafsir, not that many people have it, especially those people who don't read Arabic, I don't think they would have it for any reason. And in other words, he makes a kind of tadlis or deception in that note. And he does this on a few other occasions also in tafsir. So his tafsir is very dangerous for that reason. And he leads you to believe that what he's saying is what some of the earlier scholars said, while in fact, if you study it closer, he is misinterpreting or misquoting what the earlier scholars said. Inshallah, on that point, I will end and perhaps open the floor for questions or comments.
Thank you, Shaykh.
Thank you. I said it's much better than the old one, but still there's some bumps that you have.
Okay. So since you see some bumps, or any kind of intention to make.
Well, I don't have any. I don't think it's necessary for us to keep working on the same translation necessarily. And if you keep revising Abdullaah Yusuf Ali, well, if we do that, then we'll end up with nothing. So. Yeah, inshallah, we might provide some alternative. Not me, but Bashir Publication.
Which is wrong by you?
Which is me, actually. to be more honest. Not soon. And it would not be the whole Quran. We have, for example, Tafseer Surat al-Fatiha, large Tafseer Surat al-Fatiha, and Tafseer Surat al-Baqarah, that we publish sometimes in Al-Bashir, is from those collections. And it will not be the entire Quran. But there is, Jafar Sheikh Idris told me that there is a new translation of the Quran coming out. He told me it's very good. He promised to send me a copy to look over. So maybe inshallah there will be some new ones coming out that are better inshallah.
Okay.
Crazy with
the translation of the Quran by T.D.
Irving. Do I have a what? Rating?
Yeah.
Get a three.
On what scale?
On any scale you like. No matter what the scale, it gets a three.
It's supposed to be modern English, as I understand it.
Yeah, personally, I don't care for it. I think he the Quran is tough enough to translate the way it is, but he just loses the meaning of the Quran sometimes. I mean, he tries to make it too, almost slang, almost. You know, I mean, he tries to make it too modern English that sometimes you need a difficult word or old word to really convey what the Quran is saying at that point. Not everything can be broken down to simple words or modern terms.
Okay. Any more? Okay, let me ask you, brother.
So we have a lecture here. It's impossible. Could you tell it? Could you close this door and use the other door, please? Would you? Yaqi, you delay that. Please close the door. Brother Jamal, you said, like, the verse of no people, in fact, you quoted the verse, لَهُمُ الْفُسْنَ وَالْزِيَادَ. They have al-fusna and additional things, which is, you interpret it as seeing Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Not me.
I mean, you know, the interpretation you choose is seeing Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
This is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's interpretation of
the verse. Okay. What do you say for the verse, of course, the other theme, which does not believe in that, use the verse that says لَا تُدْرِكُوا الْأَبْصَارُ وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارُ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ, or the vision will not see Allah and Allah will be able to see them. They cannot see Allah with their eyes, but Allah will be able to see them with his eyes. So what do you think of this verse?
Read the verse again in Arabic.
لَا تُدْرِكُوا الْأَبْصَارُ وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارُ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ.
That's Tudrik, by the way, you're Arab. What's the meaning of Tudrik exactly?
Well, you know the Arabic language, and a word, as you said, might have different meanings. So, La Tudrik al-Afsar means cannot grasp him, if I translate it word to word. But what is the meaning of grasp him? So, could you just elaborate on that?
Well, first of all, Yani, if we're saying that if we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, that we'll see all there is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not what we're saying. And this is, I think you missed what that is.
Okay, could you say it again?
I said that if we say that we'll be given the pleasure of seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, that doesn't mean the same thing as that we will be able to, yani, with our sight encompass all that there is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is what the verse implies. Well, that's still true, yani, according to, not my interpretation, but according to what the Prophet says.
Yeah, but the word absar itself, the eyes, see, that's, or the vision.
Yeah.
You didn't touch on that one. I agree with you, by the way. Yeah. I mean, you know, I think, I'm just bringing to your attention the argument of the other people.
No, but what I'm
because
saying,
they're basing their argument on the Quran too.
No,
you see what I'm saying?
But as I said, yani, to interpret the Quran, you have to go to the Sunnah of the Prophet. One time, Imran bin Hussein was reading some hadith, and someone told him that what you are saying is contradicted by the Quran. Yani, these hadith of the Prophet is contradicted by the Quran. And his answer was, the Prophet of Allah knows the Quran better than you know, better than anyone knows. Well, al-absar, yani, I don't have to discuss it because already in the word tudrik, yani, the refutation is clear.
You have a question? Okay.
As-salamu alaykum.
Alaykum.
I think from hearing you, I feel that you know more Arabic than the Arabic-speaking language. You pronounce it very well. And I want to get advice for the teenagers who are born here and raised here, how to encourage them to read Arabic fluently and understand it, not just read it to please parents. Jazakallah khair.
It's not exactly related to the topic. Well, as Hamid knows, I hate to answer any questions. Is this for me? You don't have to take
it. We have a dessert for you, by the way. After we finish this, we'll have the dessert.
And I think if you really want to understand, as Brother Surat said earlier today, even the Surat and reading the Quran, I think if you really have the desire to understand what it means, and not just get it through translation or to read it without understanding the meaning, if you really have that desire, and it just will drive you to, I think, learn the Arabic language, at least enough to be able to understand in general. And you don't have to understand in detail. Even many Arabs, they don't understand in detail. I won't point anyone out particularly here, but that's not necessary. But yeah, I mean, still you'll understand what is going on and what is being said. Well, if you realize the importance of Arabic in understanding the Quran and understanding the Hadith, and also if you realize the importance in Arabic in getting good literature. I mean, what we have in English isn't much.
I want to put some play on the table.
If you have in English isn't much. I mean, you can read it within a year, I would say. If a Muslim just sat down and wanted to read most of what we have in English. And also, the quality is not like what you find in Arabic. So if someone also wants to go beyond that to really learn about Islam, he will be forced, or at least he will feel the need to learn Arabic. So if you're talking about youth, for example, if you're talking about your children, you should instill them with the feeling that if they really want to understand the Quran, if they really want to understand Allah's message to them, that they're going to have to understand some Arabic. And just trust this fact that the good books are in Arabic, the Hadith are in Arabic, the Quran is in Arabic. And inshallah, this will make them think to work at least on Arabic and to understand inshallah.
Okay, one last question. You know, you talked about...
The question was actually written in British English. And I was wondering if you could refer us to a translation which was for an American audience, written in an American style English.
Well, T.B. Irving's translation. I mean,
this is the one you had referred to, and you said it had some...
T.B. Irving's is written in English. It's called, I think, the first American version of the Quran or something like that. Even the name, I can't really put up with that name.
Right, you said there was some slang with that.
He doesn't really give you the message of the Quran. There is, Hicksal's English is very readable. The other one by Mohsin Khan, and is this by Mohsin Khan? Or, I can't remember if he translated by himself or with someone else. His English is very readable, but there's lots of typing errors and lots of grammatical mistakes. But it's very readable. Unfortunately, right now we don't really have good translations.
You came late.
The best translation, I may say so, the best translation, we're just talking about the text of the Quran, is Muhammad Ali's translation. He's Qadiani, and in his footnotes he brings out his Qadiani stuff. But his translation actually is very good. Also, A.J. Arbery's translation to some extent also is good. He's non-Muslim. But his translation, he tries to capture some of the beauty of the Quran. That was already here. Yes.
Okay, brothers. I guess I have another question, but I'll delay it, and we'll stop at this point, unless you have a...
No, Muhammad Ali. In some verses he translates many verses much better than anyone else. But he is Qadiani and his footnotes are full of none. So you cannot give that translation to anyone unless you sit there and cut out all of the footnotes.
And we quoted more than, I guess, at least started counting more than 6 or 7, you know, problems with mistakes in it, and just in Surat Al-Baqarah, as Brother Jamaal was quoting. So we have to be very cautious in dealing with his translation. Okay, I'd like to thank all of you for attending to tonight's program. I hope, inshallah, learned something out of it. And we'll see you all tomorrow. Before you leave, make sure you get the dessert, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma.